So for those who are watching, the Supreme Court, it was last year, right? The Supreme Court essentially dismissed, right, the case against Vhong Navarro. But let's go back so we can show what was in the CCTV footage. And in this particular case, the CCTV footage was a make or break in the case, because wow, that was glaring. So in January 2022, 2014, actress Deniece Cornejo files a complaint with the Southern Police District in BGC, and she claims that Navarro allegedly raped her. So let's start with that, the accusation of rape and what the CCTV footage shows. And I hope we can show the CCTV footage. Go ahead, attorney.
Well, like I told you the last time, this story actually begins not with the rape accusation, but the fact that Mr. Vhong Navarro was detained, mauled, and monies were extorted from him. The reason there was a police blotter, he was forced to sign a police blotter. He was told that if he did his part, and the part was in paying damages to Deniece, the police blotter would disappear. There was an expectation on the part of the accused, therefore, that Mr. Navarro would pay.
Oh, so the police blotter is blackmail. That police blotter in Jan 2022, 2014 was blackmail.
Yes, Karen, because obviously when they detained Mr. Navarro, he had no monies with him, right? He was just wearing shorts. And the only way they could get the monies was for him to be released, to go to the bank and deposit monies in Deniece Cornejo's bank account. But how would they be assured that he would do that? So they had the crime plotted with the instruction that, oh, Vhong, gawin mo lang ito, gawin mo yung sinasabi namin at mawawala yung police blotter. That's what happened. That's what happened. So what happened after that? Mr. Navarro, at the advice of his friends and family who cared for him, encouraged him to say his truth. And he was in the hospital when he decided he would complain with the NBI. And the reaction of the accused when they learned that was that they texted Vhong Navarro, cursing him and telling him, ganyan pala, ganun pala, and then magagaguhan tayo, etc. Before that, they had already texted Mr. Vhong Navarro the bank account number of Deniece Cornejo. And they were very surprised that Mr. Vhong Navarro, you know, got the courage to say his truth.
Yeah. Oh, and how much were they asking before?
Well, it started with 200,000. And then it increased to 500,000. The 200,000 was when he was still in the condominium unit. And they said it was for damages, which is really amazing. Damages for a rape that never occurred. Damages to the furniture, allegedly, of Mr. Vhong Navarro, of Deniece Cornejo. But when the NBI looked at the condominium unit, it was intact. The television that they said was destroyed, it was high up in the ceiling. How could it be destroyed? And you know, the only damage there really was the sofa of Deniece Cornejo. It was damaged because blood from Mr. Vhong Navarro stained the sofa. So that's what they were asking damages for.
So essentially, going back to this 10-year-old case, is Vhong Navarro really saw, the CCTV shows it, saw Deniece Cornejo for some reason. No? He wanted to meet her, I guess. That's been established. He admitted that. But she entrapped him. Is that fair to say? She entrapped him. The CCTV footage shows she went down, hindi umiiyak. I hope we can show that. Tapos sinundo niya, sina Cedric Lee. Has that been established? What is the motivation of Deniece Cornejo for doing it in the first place? She could just choose not to see Vhong Navarro. Why would a woman go through all the trouble of entrapping someone like Vhong Navarro? Anong dahilan?
Well, we will have to ask her that. Yeah. But they have studiously maintained until now, regurgitating the same story that somehow a rape had happened when no rape happened. you know, the fact of the matter is 5 days before January 22, 2014, Deniece Cornejo and Vhong Navarro did meet in her condominium unit. And they had a mutual encounter, physical encounter. And immediately after that happened, Deniece Cornejo continued to communicate with Vhong, asking that they meet up. And Vhong finally agreed to meet on January 22, 5 days later. In fact, it was a central point, according to the court, that if Deniece Cornejo had in fact been raped 5 days earlier, why would she even ask him to come back? And if you will remember, Karen, when we talked about this, you will recall that Deniece Cornejo filed a number of complaints. She even filed a petition for a protection order with the regional trial court. And her consistent story before that was they did meet on January 17. Nothing happened because Mr. Vhong Navarro, she asked him to leave and he did, before suddenly changing her story when the CCTV footage came out. Why? Well, obviously, as a way of leveraging the entire situation. But repeatedly under oath saying that nothing happened on January 17. That was her consistent story before she changed her mind. So what was her motivation? To our mind, it was very clear that it was a setup. The court of the regional trial court did decide and determine that yes, the entire thing was premeditated for the purpose of extorting monies from Mr. Vhong Navarro.
But I'm curious, attorney. I mean, I know this is many years ago. When you were at the court hearings, do you believe that she did encounter Vhong Navarro, but was she in a relationship with Cedric Lee? And was she threatened somehow by Cedric Lee? Was she fearful of him?
I do not know, Karen. All I find inexplicable is why Deniece Cornejo, despite the CCTV footages, despite her sworn statements to the contrary, has steadfastly maintained that for some reason, Mr. Vhong Navarro raped her. By the way, the regional trial court also found it significant that there were CCTV footages showing Cedric Lee kissing her, kissing Deniece Cornejo in the elevator just shortly after they came back from the police station. So we can only speculate at this time. My truth and what I believe is that, yes, there must have been some kind of understanding what the nature of the relationship was. Mm-hmm. I do not really know. But what I cannot understand is this steadfast, despite evidence to the contrary, this insistence that somehow the rape happened. It could not have happened.
I agree. And for a woman, I mean, being a woman myself, is at some point when the evidence is so clear, why would you protect someone who you know is guilty? I mean, strategically speaking, even common sense, why would you side with that person? That's what's baffling for Deniece Cornejo, right?
Yes. And for me, what really frustrated me about this is because, you know, when a woman cries rape, my own instinct, I've counseled many women and I've helped many women. And when they tell me they had been raped, my first instinct is to believe them, Karen.
Absolutely.
But this is a case where I could not, much as I wanted to, I could not believe her. And it was frustrating for me because when a woman is shown to have lied, as in this case about a rape incident, it negatively impacts upon the ability of other women to speak their truth. And that's what's frustrating for me as an advocate for women and as a person who would encourage women to fight for their rights. Pag may maling ginawa sa inyo, I know that the process is arduous. It's not a joke, Karen. Litigating a rape complaint, you expose yourself to the humiliation. And I always tell the victims, you can do it. You can do it because I believe you. And it does not do well for our cause, Karen. When these things happen, a palpable demonstration of a woman doing what many men say, that, you know, women make up stories just to get back at men. And I hate that.
Yeah. And not only that, it's the whole idea of, here's Deniece Cornejo. She's a young woman with her life ahead of her. Yes. If she just turned to witness for Vhong Navarro and told the truth, she would not probably be in correctional today. Right?
Who knows? I believe that. Karen.
It baffles the mind why she would stick to the lie at the cost of her own freedom.
Yes. And especially given, as I said, the CCTV footages and her sworn declarations, you've already put yourself in a corner. I wonder if she had gotten advice about that. I will leave it to her lawyers, but I really, like you, it is inexplicable to me, actually.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Attorney Mallonga, what do you believe? I mean, this is such a big victory. I mean, for justice, for truth, right? You know what it's like in the Philippines? Minsan, ang mga kaso na i-impluensyahan ng kung sino ang nakaupo. So pag-usapan natin yun, when Vhong Navarro was detained, nung bumaliktad yung kwento, siya na nga yung binugbog, he was mauled, he was extorted money, and then ang nangyari, he was detained for rape, right? At one point. Do you believe back then that there was a political hand in it?
I did not want to speculate, Karen. We were all focused on setting Mr. Navarro free. And I have to tell you, I did say it was a very surreal experience. It was, it violated everything that I knew about what the correct legal process was. It was the first time that I had seen the Court of Appeals, knowing that there is still recourse to the Supreme Court, actually directing the Department of Justice to already file charges against Mr. Navarro. Not later, after our motion for reconsideration had been resolved, but now. It said now.
Hindi ko political yun, tanong ko. Si Cedric Lee ba noon malakas? May connection siya sa nakaraang administrasyon?
I do not know, Karen, but I have heard that Mr. Cedric Lee has made many boasts about his capabilities. I will not say what these are, but they do have some significant implications on his ability to do certain things about this case. Mm-hmm. I do not want to think of that now, because I said, you know, people ask me how Mr. Navarro felt when he learned about this and how I feel. And happiness, you know, saying that we were happy seems to be inadequate.
Uh-oh.
But it's beyond happiness. It's some kind of, there's a sense of serenity and tranquility at the same time about, you know, the thing that you had been doing all the time, just accepting everything that went our way. Before the promulgation of judgment, I had texted the members of the legal team. And by the way, I have to say their names and I have to congratulate them. And then these were my attorney, Bon Arcelia, attorney Christopher Capul, attorney Justin Mendoza, and our wonderful prosecutors from the Department of Justice, prosecutor Mariel Herrera, Hazel Valdez, Olive Torrevillas, who have stood by with us 10 years, Karen, from the very beginning. They had been dedicated. They had shown fortitude, doggedness in pursuing this case. And like me, sharing my sentiment of never giving up, never giving up, even despite, you know, the very grim setbacks. Mm-hmm. So in a way, for Vhong Navarro, when he was asked, yes, he was happy, but at the same time, he could not categorically say that, he could not express it in that manner, because he said this was a roller coaster ride for him, not only in terms of what happened to him, the trauma that that caused, but his name was being bandied about. He became the the victim of a lot of
his reputation was destroyed. Yes.
And he did say that in a way he hopes that he can really start to move on. And we feel the same way, Karen. You were witness to the conclusion of a particular chapter of this journey. And I think for most Filipino people, this is a 10-year saga. They saw it before their eyes. Many people, almost all people, would have an opinion in this. All I ask and I pray is that maybe, pwede ba, let's stop speculating about the possibility that perhaps Vhong Navarro could have committed it, could have done something wrong. Please stop.
Clearly.
But justice already said no.
Yeah.
Court has said no. The Supreme Court has said no. In fact, the Supreme Court said no amount of any skillful conversation or deportment before a court could repair the damage that had already been done by the highly doubtful and inconsistent statements of Deniece. Sabi ng Supreme Court, wala na, nandyan na yan eh.
Uh-oh.
But still, people, you know, one thing that this case has cost me, Karen, I don't do Facebook. I don't read comments. I don't read up commentaries on this particular case because I'm just determined to do my job and the negative commentary doesn't help. And so please, my request is for all those who may have some desire to seal exact some kind of insidious insinuations from all of this, if I can ask, please, let us rejoice in this demonstration of justice at work and the principle that the road to justice may be hard, but if we keep on persisting, we keep on praying, we keep on being focused on the duty at hand, we will somehow reach our destination. It may come later, it may come sooner, but we should persist.
Okay. Now, I'm sure this is going to be part of many law lessons, right? I mean, this particular case. But just offhand before we close, you know, I mean, the O.J. Simpson trial, do you remember? Now no one knows if he was guilty or not because the lawyer said, try on the glove, and it didn't fit. But this one, what part of the evidence do you believe was the strongest that actually made the Supreme Court decide on Vhong Navarro's side and that the Taguig court already convict them? I'm sure you submitted a lot of evidence, but what was for you the closer, the strongest evidence there?
The CCTV footages were not viewed by the Supreme Court.
Wow. Wait, didn't watch the CCTV footage? Yung si Deniece Cornejo, hindi umiiyak, hindi tumatakbo, tumatawa siya, kalmado. Hindi nila yun napanood, pero dinismiss nila ang kaso.
Yes, because at the end of the day, the Supreme Court focused on the testimony of Deniece Cornejo herself, the doubtfulness of her account, the inconsistencies of her account. And it said, given the fundamental inconsistencies, there was no way, Supreme Court said, that this could be cured by any other testimony that she could possibly make in proceedings moving forward, even in court. So at the end of the day, there is a legal truism, Karen, that basically says that there is no test to the truth of human testimony except its conformity with our knowledge, with our observation and experience. You know, at the end of the day, logic matters, human experience matters.
Good point.
And everything that happened here, the fact that Deniece Cornejo, for example, said she was not raped before suddenly reversing herself, the fact that she supposedly was raped 5 days earlier after backtracking, but then invited him to go see her again in the very same condominium unit where she was supposedly raped. And during trial, Karen, not many people know this, a lot of security guards testified that after the supposed rape, they saw Deniece. She was very calm. And all she asked them was directions for the main office. And she was telling, can you please assist me in making sure that a certain Eleanor Nang does not get to come to to Forbes Wood to visit me? All the while she was saying this, Vhong Navarro was in her condominium unit at the second floor. She made no mention about this. Also the fact that the next day she went back to the security office to say, somebody robbed me. She did not say a single word about a rape that had supposedly happened.
So she mentioned somebody robbed me, but didn't say somebody raped me.
Yes, yes. And in the midst of the supposed rape where Vhong Navarro was
there,
being detained, she did not mention them. All she was saying was, pwede ba itong si Eleanor nang? I don't want
her to down. Come see me. She went down the lobby to speak to the guard.
To the guards and in the entrance to say that. And of course, at the end of the day, the trial court here noted the concerted action of the accused.
Okay, so that's one. That's one. What about the Taguig conviction? Okay, what do you think was the strongest there? So other than perhaps Deniece Cornejo's inconsistent testimony, did the CCTV footage play a big role?
Of course.
With the
conviction?
Yeah.
Yes, the Taguig court specifically mentioned the CCTV footages. Yeah. But other than that, as I said, it did go into an examination of the testimonies of all the other witnesses. For example, with respect to Cedric Lee and his complicity, she did know that it was very odd that it was Cedric Lee and his sister, Bernice Lee, who complained as witnesses about the rape and made it appear that they had witnessed it when in fact they were not even there. And the fact that Mr. Cedric Lee admitted to sending out a series of texts where he gave up the bank account numbers of the bank account number of Deniece Cornejo.
He
and
admitted
said,
that in court.
Yes, yes, because he had to. The text messages were there and telling Vhong Navarro, pag ginawa mo ulit yan, yung nangyari sa'yo sa amin, hindi lang yun ang mangyayari sa'yo. And the trial court said, oh, that is an admission that you did do something to Mr. Vhong Navarro. It's a very explicit admission. To the mind of the court, there was proof beyond reasonable doubt. And by the way, Karen, that's a very, very high threshold.
Yeah.
To accomplish.
Yeah. Well, on that note, we don't have enough time, but I do hope to have you again on the Head Start. I think this is good to discuss. I think 10 years, too long, but you know the saying, justice delayed is justice denied. Just very quickly, do you feel that way with that phrase now? Justice is delayed, but do you feel it's denied?
No. No. I think I have improved for the better. With this case, it has made me more patient. It's made me less impetuous. Mm. It has made me less cynical. Mm. And that's very important because I do plan to engage in litigation some more years from now.
Yeah.
So it is, I now disavow that. If you get justice by whatever means, however long it takes, it's worth the fight. Karen, I enjoin everybody, kung may karapatan kayo, ipaglaban natin, never give up.
All right. On that note, I want to thank you for joining me today and good luck to you. More good work to be done. Attorney Alma Mallonga, the lawyer of Vhong Navarro. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen.